A very good morning and welcome to the fifth meeting of the Criminal Justice Committee in 2023. We have no apologies this morning, and our first item of business today is consideration of the Scottish Government's response to our pre-budget scrutiny report, and I refer members to paper one. So I intend to allow about 25 minutes or so for this session, and I'll just simply open it up to members for discussion and agreement on any follow-up as required. So I think in the spirit of efficiency, I'll maybe just start. I'll come to you, Russell Findlay, for any comments that you want to make on the response.
Can you maybe come back to me? Is that okay?
I can.
Thank you.
Colette.
I'm fairly okay in terms of the capital budget. I'd like to get more clarification on that, particularly in light of the fact that Greenock as well, HMP Greenock and the prisons, is a cause for concern given what we heard previously in the evidence sessions. Other than that, I'm fairly comfortable with everything else, really, other than the capital spend.
Okay, thanks very much. Jamie?
Thank you. I've got a few different items to discuss, but I don't want to impinge on other members' opportunities to speak, but maybe I can kick off the conversation, yep, at least on some of them. I think probably the first one to start with is the Cabinet Secretary's response on the budget for the Scottish Police Authority and police budgets. And I just wanted to probe a little bit into that. First of all, there is an important clarification from the Cabinet Secretary over our report around police budgets. Now, when we took pre-budget scrutiny evidence, it was made quite clear to us that there would be a very direct knock-on effect on police numbers in terms of budget in proportion to a flat cash settlement or a real terms cut, depending on how you phrase it. And it's an area that I probed, I think, quite vociferously on. The Cabinet Secretary wanted us to make clear that we said in our report that he said, and I quote, that he had no intention of overseeing, that he had no intention of cutting police officers or staff numbers. And I say that in the context of the evidence that we took, that that is what would happen. There would be a reduction in frontline officers or back office staff. Now, he's replied in his comments that he says this, thinks this is an inaccurate reflection of what he said. It may not necessarily have been a I need to look at a report, actually, and see what we did say that he said. But it certainly was the essence of what he said. So we may have misquoted him we've misquoted him in our report. But that was very much what I thought he was saying. I think that's what other members thought as well, which is why we put it in our report. He's come back and said, actually, I had no intention of overseeing a budget for the police force that results in 4,000 officers leaving. Well, that's welcome. I don't think that's a position any Cabinet Secretary would want to be in. But that seems to be, in my view, falling quite short of a commitment that there will not be a reduction in police officer numbers. So what is quite unclear is whether that then leads us to surmise that there will be a potential reduction in officer numbers or staff numbers, and that if that were to be the case, the Cabinet Secretary would be content with that, given that he has watered down his position. Now, I appreciate in the next paragraph it says that an additional £80 million of resource has been allocated. I presume, and this can be clarified, that is resource budget, not capital budget, and it is unclear whether that is intended to meet any percentage pay rises that are asked for or that are settled, given that we don't know the final outcome of those negotiations. So my fear is that even with the £80 million, what we don't have is evidence of what that would translate to. So if all the £80 million would do is simply be swallowed up in a inflationary pay rise, then we would be left with a static number of police officers. If that would not be enough to cover any pay rise, and I think you would need to look at this on a percentage basis, what does 4% look like? What does 5%? What does 6%? What does 10% look like? Then we still could be in a situation where we're seeing a reduction in police officers. We still could be losing frontline police officers. So that, I think, is a matter of concern. And I don't think that just chucking in a number and the response clarifies, and then diverting back to saying, well, these are all matters for the Chief Constable and operational matters, which they are. But, you know, we should be evidence-led when we're scrutinising budget. And I don't see that, I don't see how we can marry up the statement that there may not be 4,000 officers leaving, but there still may be a substantial number of officers leaving. And I don't know what effect the £80 million will have and where that money will actually go into the service and how it will be spent. It's a bit late now, of course, but I found it opened up more questions than answers. I've got other comments on other parts of the response, on specific around the prison service and legal aid, but I'll maybe just stop there in case other members want to talk about the police budget first.
Yep. Okay, thanks, Jamie. I'll come back to the matter of the wording in the Cabinet Secretary's response to our report, but I'll move on to Katie. Although, did you have your hand up, Rona?
It was really just a supplementary to Jamie. But you said you're going to talk about the... I mean, I understand what Jamie's saying. I tend to think maybe he's overthinking that a wee bit. I think the Cabinet Secretary's clearly just trying to sort of say, well, you know, we need to see the official report, number one. And it could have been taken out of context, what was in the report, slightly. And I think it's perfectly reasonable for him to say, well, these are operational matters, and I wouldn't be taking control of that. And so I think that's what it's about. But, I mean, I appreciate Jamie would like more information about where that money would go. But, again, that's up to the chief. So.
OK, thanks, Rona. I mean, if while we're on the subject then, I mean, I think in my interpretation of the comments that he's made in his reply, so at the bottom of page 3 across into page 4, is more about the sort of interpretation of the wording that was recorded in the official report on that particular session and is also replicated in our own budget scrutiny report. So what he did say is reflected accurately in both of those documents, in the official report and our budget scrutiny report. He has made reference to the fact that in paragraph 7, we have paraphrased what he has said, as you've highlighted, Jamie. My view is there wasn't any intention to mislead on the exact phrase or represent what he said in committee, and that seems to have resulted in him feeling it was necessary to highlight what he felt might be interpreted as an inaccurate account of what he said. So I'm happy, it was my intention to raise this with members, and obviously, Jamie, you've made your sort of views on the sort of wider issue of the police budget. You've set them out just now. Pauline, do you want to come in on this?
Just since it was on that point, so I start by saying I don't think for a minute the Cabinet Secretary was, you know, intending to mislead the committee in any way. I don't think that for a second. However, I totally agree with what Jamie said. That's what I took it to mean. I was really pleased when he said it. And this doesn't make sense to me. My understanding is Chief Constable said if this flatline budget is, you know, the final outcome, that it's going to result in 4 point, whatever the figure was, leaving the police force. Well, I was not leaving, but I thought you'd have to let them leave or cut, is what I assumed it meant. But the way he rephrased it, I said, I have no intention of overseeing a budget for the police force that results in 4,000, that's okay so far, 4,000 officers leaving. if you see the distinction they're making, that doesn't make sense. The question wasn't 4,000 officers leaving, it's we couldn't fund 4,000 police officers. That's what I thought the issue was.
So just to come back on that, I mean, my interpretation of the him raising this is that, as you said, Rona, this is ultimately it's an operational decision for the Chief Constable to make, and what he said in the session was that he had no intention of overseeing a budget for the police force that results in 4,000 officers leaving. The concern he's raised is that the paraphrasing of that is misrepresenting what he said. So I don't particularly want to get kind of caught up in the minutiae of what is in our report by way of a paraphrase set against what he actually said. I think if there are still questions around the budget, then I'm happy for us to go back to him with those questions, because this is, you know, this is important. So you want to come in with anything just over and above the...
If it helps the committee, maybe, because I did look into this when we saw the response from the Cabinet Secretary, had discussed with the convener before. As far as I understand the point the Cabinet Secretary is trying to make at the bottom of page 3, in your report or your letter that you published a few months back, you said at paragraph 67, you quoted the Cabinet Secretary directly from the official report, and the quote that you used was that the Cabinet Secretary had said he had, quotes, no intention of overseeing a budget for the police force, excuse me, that results in 4,000 officers leaving, unquote. But when it came to the conclusions of your report at paragraph 77, the committee paraphrased that with the following statement. The committee welcomes a statement from the Cabinet Secretary that he has no intention of cutting police officer and staff numbers. And I think the point the Cabinet Secretary is making in his letter to you is that he is not the person that cuts police numbers. That's a matter for the Chief Constable. And he just didn't want that confusion to be clear, that he'd said he'd no intention of overseeing a budget, whereas we'd paraphrased saying, perhaps inferring that it's his decisions on police numbers. And I think he was just drawing that to the committee's attention. I hope that helps.
Jamie?
Yeah, no, I understand what he's saying. I know what we said, and I know what he said, and I know what he's now he's saying. And I don't think he's changed his position. I'm not accusing him of doing that. I'm less interested in that, and more interested in the context and the content of it. And that's the fact that it is welcome that he will not preside over a budget which will see a loss of 4,000 officers. Nobody wants to see a loss of 4,000 officers. I think the inference from the exchange that we had was that there would not be a cut of that nature. Whether he does it or whether the Chief Constable does it is irrelevant. He then goes on to say that we found some cash in the pot, which again is welcome. No one has a problem with that. But what I don't know is that if he may not be content presiding over a budget which results in 4,000 officers lost, but it may be 3,000 instead, or 2,000, or 1,000, we don't know is the answer. So I think there are unanswered questions. And if it's correct that these are operational matters for the police, not the Cabinet Secretary, then we should be asking the police what the £80 million will be spent on, and if, in that context, they are still looking at the potential reduction in officer numbers. And I say that because officer numbers at the moment are at their lowest level since 2008. So any suggestion that they will drop any further, I think, should be a matter of concern for the committee.
OK, thanks. So I think the key things there, Jamie, if I'm right, are how will the additional funding, how will that be used? And there's perhaps a question in and around that for Police Scotland as well as for the Cabinet Secretary. Is that
what you're... it's all about officer numbers. I mean, what I think we want to know, or we should want to know, is are we still looking down the barrel of a reduction in officer numbers, or are we looking at a flat cash, flat settlement of officer numbers, or indeed is there sufficient budget there to increase officer numbers, which would be welcome news if that's the case. But we don't know.
So are members happy that we perhaps write and ask those questions. I think those are legitimate, and we can write to the Cabinet Secretary and Police Scotland on that. That'd be okay. Thank you. Okay, Katie.
Just a small addendum to that. It would be helpful just to get clarification on the position in terms of civilian police staff as well.
Okay.
Because in the past, what has happened, because of the political contention of cutting officer numbers, disproportionately civilian police staff have taken the hit, and that does have quite a significant impact, obviously, on the service. So perhaps that could be incorporated in the letter. I think generally, I think the point that we need to make is that initially we were looking at cuts of the region of 20% to justice budgets when we started this conversation quite a number of months ago. There has been significant movement on that, and whilst we're still seeing real terms cuts, like big cuts in justice budgets, it's not in the region of the levels that initially we were looking at, and I suspect that's partly, maybe, hopefully, as a result of some of the work we've done, but the Cabinet Secretary going and making representations strongly and presumably fighting his case. So I think we're not looking as bad a picture as we thought we would have been at the beginning of this process, but we are still looking at drastic cuts. And I know, I think we were going to ask Spice to clarify exactly what the nature of those cuts are, so that it isn't a party political point, if you like, that there's an agreed acceptance of what we're actually talking about in terms of the cuts that the justice sector is facing. But they are significant. I mean, it's clear that there could be ways to spend less money in the justice system. The obvious example is prisons. The fact that we put so many people in prison is very, very expensive. But there's none of the structural changes really that would be necessary within the budget that we're looking at that's going to really enable those kind of you know, if you like, cost saving, long-term cost savings to take place. And that's obviously a discussion we're having in relation to the bail bill that we're looking at in terms of how we put money into the other parts of the justice sector that would enable custodial sentences to be used less. So I think that's always a point worth making. In terms of, I echo the points that have been made on police, and it may well be that Pauline McNeill will come in more than that. But just to pick out a couple of points, again, on the capital budget to do with prisons, we've heard evidence that it's a lot cheaper to house people in newer prisons. I visited Greenock Prison 2 weeks ago. It's quite clear that there is, you know, an urgent need for capital spending to be made available to Greenock. If that doesn't happen, there is a real risk that Greenock will not be able to stay in operation. So I do think that's a specific issue that's been highlighted to us as a committee by the Chief Inspector of Prisons, and a huge cause for concern. Obviously, a number of us here represent West Scotland, and there is, as well as the justice issues, there's a big economic impact that would result if that prison was to close in the Inverclyde area. So I think that is a point I'd want to make. But also in terms of capital spending, we've had very strong representations from the Fire Brigade Union in relation to capital spending. Also, in addition to the carcinogenic nature of many of the toxins that firefighters are exposed to, and of course, we've already this year had a tragic death of a firefighter in the Jenners fire that brings home the risks of that employment. But a number of other, you know, firefighters were hospitalised, and we know that the cancer levels and leukaemia levels from firefighters are far higher than the general population as a result to the work exposure. There's over 100 fire stations that do not have proper sanitation facilities, and I do think that's a point that we need to put forward as something that really needs to be given far greater priority.
Okay, thanks, Katie. So quite a range of issues covered there. Are there specific points that you would like the committee to go back to the Cabinet Secretary, or are you just wanting to note these for the record?
I think both the civilian point in the letter that we're writing to do with the police and the Greenock prison issue. I've already written to the Cabinet Secretary about it, but I think it would be useful if the committee was to raise that also, and also the issue to do with capital spend for fire stations, given I believe that the fire service is actually in breach of its duty of care to provide safe systems of work to firefighters. And from a health and safety perspective, the work is required urgently to bring fire stations up to standard to ensure that firefighters can wash after you know, being involved in incidents.
Mm-hmm. OK. Thanks for that. I don't disagree with those points. I note in the Cabinet Secretary's response, they're looking at a capital budget for the Scottish Prison Service of £97 million in order to continue this modernisation programme. So that's welcome, but very necessary. And I think it comes back to the point that you made, Colette, earlier on about sort of clarity around capital budget. OK. Thanks very much, Katie. Pauline. In fact, Russell, are you wanting to come in? Pauline.
And I know I've got one point, but I'm happy. I've just got one additional point, and that's okay. Again, back to the police budget issue. I mean, the £80 million additional resource, I mean, I suppose we need to know how does that square with the statement the Cabinet Secretary has made that he's no intention of presiding over a budget which would result in 4,000 officers leaving. So I don't know what then £80 million does that, I don't know what that actually means. So I would be concerned then if that £80 million doesn't represent a figure that would prevent 4,500 officers from leaving. Mm-hmm. I don't know. Do we pursue this from here with the Police Service Authority, or is that something we pursue with the Cabinet Secretary?
Yeah. I think perhaps that's what our intention was in terms of writing to the Cabinet Secretary and Police Scotland, was to get some clarification on what that spending would look like. Is it going to be used largely to settle pay deals? So I think it would be appropriate for us to follow that up, if you're happy with that.
Yeah.
OK, thank you. Right, I'll come back to Russell and then I'll bring in Fulton.
Thank you. I found my notes. So two observations about what's been said so far and two quick points to make. The first one is in respect to the fire service. Katie Clark's bang on. I mean, the acting chief fire officer told us he needed something like £500 million just to bring infrastructure up to standard due to year after year of not having enough money to do so. I totally understand the point Jamie's making as well. It makes sense that while the Cabinet Secretary wasn't stating that was his intent, or nonetheless that is the outcome, and I think we've agreed a form of way to deal with that. Now, the two other points I wanted to raise was Scottish Police Authority. It says that, or he says that £45.5 million for investment in police assets, including the estate, fleet and technology, which, for all that, isn't a lot of money. Now, in December, Police Scotland said that they would finally be rolling out body-worn cameras for their officers, the only force in the UK not to have them, other than a few hundred for specialist firearms officers. And I just think I want to understand, this was described in the media as a £20 million programme over 5 years. So does it follow, therefore, that this 23-24 sum of money, £4 million of that goes towards body-worn cameras? I'd just like some clarity about the speed in which the body-worn cameras are going to be delivered, because it is crucial to helping police officers primarily, but also public confidence. So it's just, if it's worth getting a bit of a breakdown and explanation. I know it's an operational decision that they're spending this money, but the media stuff's not very clear. And the second point is around the prison service. There's no reference whatsoever to, as far as I can see, the fact HMP Kilmarnock is either now or is on the cusp of becoming under the direct control of the government, with all the costs associated with that, and HMP Arrimwell is about to follow. It does talk about the cost of private sector contracts, but I don't know if that means the likes of the one we touched upon, the provision of food and dairy produce and so on to the prisoners. But, you know, Kilmarnock and Arrimwell are going to end up costing a huge sum of money to run in staff costs, then the responsibility for infrastructure and maintenance, and then the pensions, I understand. So it'd be useful to know where that money's come from, how much it is.
Okay, so in relation to the SPA budget, I think I note the information provided around the figure that's been allocated for police assets, including estate, fleet and technology, as you have outlined. And we've been interested in body worn cameras for quite some time, and I think we did receive an update from the Cabinet Secretary. I wouldn't care to guess when that was, fairly recently. Again, that's an operational decision for the Chief Constable, but there is general support for that to be introduced and rolled out. Is there any, I don't think there was any further update on that
I believe it might have been a question in the chamber or a written question that the cabinet secretary updated Parliament on body worn video cameras. But were the committee minded to also ask for an update? You could incorporate that in the letter to the cabinet secretary. Yeah.
There may be things I haven't seen, but the media report was December, and it said 5 years. So 5 years is a long time. If it's going to take that long
to wait
for all officers to have
to be
the
rolled
kit.
Out.
I mean, many of the other police forces are onto second and sometimes third generation kit, which is even more efficient. So,
okay, do you want to come back in?
Only if it helps, just to clarify. So, it was I can send this to the committee afterwards. It was a written answer dated the 24th of January. So, I'll circulate that to members so you've got the latest point.
On the issues that you've raised about the prison service, again, happy to write back out with some further requests for clarification. I think the issue around private sector contract costs and some of that, those challenges linked to sort of inflation and increasing prices was a reasonable one, because it's having such a significant impact. So, and the other points that you raised about Adwell and Kilmarnock, I'm happy to write again.
How much is it going to cost? And
for some further detail
on
that. Okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Fulton, would you like to come in?
Yeah. Thanks, convener. There's a bit of an echo here, but hopefully you can all hear me okay. I think Katie Clark's actually maybe stole my thunder a wee bit there, because I was looking at the reply and I've seen it in quite a positive light from a committee point of view, because when we were taking evidence in towards the start, as Katie's already said, you know, we were looking at quite really bad cuts. It looked a very, very bleak picture. But actually what I think the Cabinet Secretary has outlined is that he's been able to invest in the justice system, you know, with the as it currently stands. And I think the committee can take some credit in that, to be honest. And I think that I just wanted to come in and be positive in that note, because this could have been a very different conversation we're having today. I think the conversation now is around the edges of things rather than the overall picture that we're perhaps first looking at. And we've got to remember as well that this is us at a very early stage in the budget process as well. So there might even be scope for further good news, if you want to put it like that. But yeah, I read it quite positively. I thought that actually we might have been in a worse position by this point. But I would echo, therefore, Katie Clark's comments. And I'd already pressed to speak as Katie was saying that. So otherwise, I would have not convened, but I wanted to put that on record anyway. Thanks.
Okay. Thanks for that, Fulton. Colette, you want to come back in, and then Jamie?
Yeah, can we just also seek clarification? It's from the bottom of paragraph 5, page 5, justice transformation, and it goes on to talk about blue light collaborations. Mm-hmm. What is that? I'm not quite sure what that means. Is they're vying money from the police reform budget over to cross justice? So just to seek clarification on that point.
Thanks. That was something that I actually had flagged in my own head as well. I'd be interested to know a wee bit more about what that £5 million of reform budget is going to be used for. A wee bit more detail, I think, would be very welcome. So we'll incorporate that into our correspondence. Jamie and then Rona.
Thank you. So just to pick up on some of my other points, some of which has already been touched on, actually, by other members. And I should say, I hope Fulton's wearing a seatbelt or he'll end up with a blue plaque next to his that tree next to his car. Mm-hmm. But I'm glad he's positive about it. But I think, you know, there's nothing positive about uncertainty around police numbers. And I think that is something that's not around the edges of the budget. It's absolutely core to delivering good public safety. I wanted to mention some other points. I would echo the comments on body-worn cameras. I think it is one of those issues that, yes, it is the minutiae of detail of operational matters, but it's a big one. I think it's inconceivable that officers should have to wait years for what is fairly simple equipment and is very standard in other forces. And I don't think that's going to go down very well at all with officers on the front line. On the fire budget, you know, my colleague Russ Finley pointed out the massive capital backlog. It says in his response that we have maintained the £32.5 million capital budget. Now, maintained, I presume that means that it still is what it was. In other words, there's no increase at all. So that is a real terms cut in the capital budget for the fire service, which I don't know how on earth is going to go any way towards some of the problems that Katie Clark identified, which we have debated in the Parliament already. And these are quite serious and, I would say, quite urgent matters. I know you can't magic new fire stations overnight. They take time to properly procure and build. That needs to be a longer-term project. But I'm pretty sure there are many fire stations right now that could do with some injection of cash to make them fit for, at least semi-fit for purpose. And I think it's absolutely deplorable that we send our firefighters into conditions like that and expect them to work in those conditions at the moment. So I still read this, and I'm willing to be corrected, as the Cabinet Secretary is happy to do in other matters, if that is a flat cash settlement for the fire service this year, which I think would come as a disappointment to them. On prisons, I would question the issue, notwithstanding comments made by the convener around the £97 million in capital funding to continue modernisation of the prison estate. It does go on to say this will include completion of the new female prison at HMP Stirling. So I don't think that's new money, I'm afraid. And again, I'm willing to be corrected if that is the case. Surely that is will just be the next tranche of the procurement and build cost of the prison. And that money would already have been known to us prior to this revised budget. So I don't think it is new magic cash. I think it's probably going in some way to resolve payments towards those who are building HMP Stirling, as it seems to imply. There are major issues around HMP Greenock, and I know we've asked about it many times and been given a very honest answer. There simply isn't enough money in the pot to do anything there. But it will close if things carry on as it is. If it does not receive cash of any shape or form, then there is an inevitability that it will close. And I don't think that's scaremongering, as was reported in local media. It's a real possibility, and I think that is an issue. The issue of legal aid is one that we haven't discussed. I wanted to bring up, and I was quite intrigued by the Cabinet Secretary's response, who I think, I'm not sure if it was meant to be in this light, but he says, in addition, following positive engagement with the legal profession, we will bring forward regulations in the year to further increase and reform legal aid fees. Nobody in the legal aid profession I've spoken to thought that the engagement was positive or indeed are happy with the outcome of that engagement. In fact, the SSBA are on the record as saying that it's better than nothing, but it doesn't really go far enough. And I think that's something that's been echoed by many others in the sector. I think there's a little bit of head and sand syndrome here. It's unclear what that additional budget will look like in fees versus what they think is required to continue to provide services. We are now starting to see, I think, the very real effects of those financial problems in the legal aid sector. I think members will probably be aware that the places like Orkney, for example, now have have little to no access to practitioners, and that is repeated right across the country. I know that's again an issue we've been raising for many years, but I don't take much positive away from that statement. And the last one is on victims, who I think is an important one. I think it was a very welcome announcement on the multi-year funding for some of the third sector organisations. That's something that another committee I sat on did a huge piece of work in the last session of Parliament, and that certainty of funding is very, very welcome. But on the Bairnshøs model, my understanding is that we were actually due, and I'm happy to be corrected by the clerks if I'm wrong, but there was actually a report due to Parliament that was going to outline the plans for future Bairnshøs models, and I think the government was doing a piece of work that would identify how many would be needed and how much budget would be required and to roll that out. I think that's overdue, that piece of work, but again, I could be corrected on that. I think that'd be quite helpful. I don't think it's going to happen in the next financial year anyway, even if it had been released, but it would give us an idea of what is happening down the line with that. I appreciate that obviously getting the first one off the ground is the priority, and that's something I do support. That's all. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Right, so I covered a wee bit there. In terms of the Scottish Fire and Rescue Service funding, I think it's pretty clear in the room that there's an interest in particularly the what has been provided. Is that sufficient? So I think it's the 32.5 million in terms of the capital budget. Is that sufficient? I think there's a mood in the room that's probably not, for the scale of the sort of reform or modernisation that is required. We could write to Scottish Fire and Rescue, ask how that will be spent, and I think importantly, what the shortfall might be on that. I suspect there will be one, and it might be quite significant. So I'm happy if members are agreeable that we correspond with Scottish Fire and Rescue on that.
Katie? I mean, just on that point, I mean, the Fire and Rescue Service is actually receiving a slight cut. I mean, it's a half, roughly, I think, £400,000 mm-hmm. cut, whereas other areas are getting slight increases. Now, I appreciate we're focusing on the capital budget, but, you know, actually, when things need to be done, often there is a discussion about whether it comes out of revenue or capital. So I think it's quite surprising that the Fire and Rescue Fire Service is getting any cut at all, mm-hmm. you know, given, you know, in particular some of the debates we've had in the Parliament, you know, that there clearly are long-term underfunding issues and we seem to be going backwards. So I think that is a point that perhaps should be incorporated in our correspondence.
And I think just finally, I think we'll just pull this discussion to a close in a moment, but I think just finally on going back to the matter of the prison service, again, we can, just to clarify, we can ask for some detail on that £97 million spend, which is set out as the capital budget for specifically for modernisation, taking into account the comments that you and Katie and I think and others have made. So are members happy with that follow-up? Yep. Okay. Perfect. Did you want to come in, Rona?
Just to say, I agree with really all the points that have been said. I'm really pleased about the victims' money and the multi-year funding. And the prison service, I'm again really pleased that the prison estate, the modernisation of the and the new female prison is going to go ahead. And what Jamie makes the point, is it magic cash, is it new money? I don't know if it is, but quite honestly, the fact that it's going to happen is the main mm-hmm. thing from my point of view.
So
I won't say any more.
No, that's fine, thanks very much for that. Okay, thank you, members. So we'll move on to our next agenda item, and that's consideration of the following negative instrument, which is the Parole Board Scotland Rules of 2022, and that's SSI 385 of 2022. And I refer members to paper 2. So as usual, I'll open it up to members if they've got any questions on the instrument. Russell?
Yeah, a couple of things. On page 4, there is reference to an issue of people convicted of murder or culpable homicide, a provision whereby the parole board could consider whether these individuals make known the whereabouts of their victims' remains. And this is something that my colleague Jamie Green's been calling for, as have I, and is indeed part of his forthcoming bill. But what puzzles me is that it goes on to say this may be considered where relevant, but does not change the underlying test for release applied by the board. So effectively, it's a superficial tweak. It says that the parole board can consider it, but it will have absolutely no effect whatsoever, which begs the question, why bother? Either do it with intent or don't do it at all. It just seems to be a bit of a sop to suggest that this is something that they're aware of. Now, I know that these cases are rare, but there are a significant enough number of them, and there are families right now who don't know where their loved ones' remains are, and prisoners who are serving a sentence do know. And if there was a meaningful way of motivating them to disclose that by virtue of what's been called Suzanne's Law in Scotland and has other names elsewhere in the UK, it should do so. The second point is around victims, and it's page 5. Now, two things about that. One is that a bit I underlined about an intended to prevent any victim getting information or contact that they do not wish to have and which may cause distress or disruption. Now, from my experience in the committee, I've not really heard any meaningful evidence that that's really an issue. The issue largely is about crime victims having to battle to get information, even where they have engaged with the victim notification scheme, which the government admits isn't doing its job and is subject to an ongoing review. The evidence we've heard is that there's barriers put up, you have to be proactive, it's all very impersonal, almost a sort of sense of hostility sometimes towards victims trying to get basic information. And I think it would be interesting to see when this victim notification scheme review, I don't know when that's due, but I'd be curious to see what they say about it, because it's clearly not working. So,
okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Yes, and the bodies. Okay. Right, noted those. Anybody else? Pauline.
Thank you.
And Jamie.
There's quite a lot contained within this SSI, and ploughing your way through it, there's a number of fairly significant issues, which is a very kind of short procedure for us to comment on something which could be extremely important. There's two issues I wish to highlight. The first is in page 4. It's in relation, there's also a new addition to the rule and decision. Summaries Rule 34 provides that the board must give reasons for a decision where it differs from the recommendations in our act, presumably it's the RMP, it's the risk management provision, is that? These provisions ensure that the most recent assessment of risk is available to the board in their consideration of such cases, and that they articulate their reasoning in reaching their decision. When I read it, I thought, well, that is quite an onerous responsibility for the parole board, because if we've got an authority who's got expert opinion taking or making a recommendation, if you're going to go against it, it's quite an onerous decision to set out. It's just an observation. Also, in prisoner representation, prisoner preparation, I read through it. So that's in relation to added to the rules to assist a person concerned to be better prepared for a parole hearing. I don't think there's any mention at literacy issues, given that it's... I just thought maybe that should have been mentioned.
Which paragraph is that?
So in the end of page 4, it talks about prisoner preparation for parole hearings, which seems a good thing. This allows information to be obtained from the person concerned in advance to assess whether they're ready to proceed. I didn't know if it was relevant or not, but it just occurred to me that a lot of prisoners, or some prisoners, will have literacy issues.
Mm-hmm.
And if you're going to help, if there's any point in introducing a new rule about preparation, it may be worth just mentioning that that should include support for any literacy issues.
Okay.
Thank you.
Jamie.
Thank you. So the first point is maybe a wider point. This is quite a big SSI, and we are looking at it in the context of the negative procedure, which, as members know, has very limited options to us. It's impossible, for example, for us to amend, or, you know, on matters like this, it's outside of our control because of the primary legislation that it's connected to, but it's the sort of thing that, had it been subject to the affirmative procedure, we could have heard from the Cabinet Secretary or his advisers on, we could have taken evidence on, we could have done other things with it, rather than simply be left with the only option of annulling it, which is unhelpful because there's some good stuff in it.
Mm-hmm.
But there's other things which aren't so good, and that's what I wanted to point towards. The first point is absolutely correct around matters that the board may consider around release, and that's specifically that of someone who's been convicted of murder or homicide, and whether they have failed to reveal the location of a victim's body, as was noted by my colleague Russell Finlay. I think this is a real missed opportunity. I think the government because this does feature in my own member's bill, yet to be drafted, however, but it did feature heavily in my consultation. And the overwhelming response to that was positive, that it should be a more overt rule when it comes to the test of release. It just simply says that this does not change the underlying test for release, but may be a factor that may be taken into account, which I presume already was a factor, so it doesn't seem to make mm-hmm. any change. And I had I been given the opportunity to amend this, I would have done and made it stronger. I think the government has missed an opportunity here to introduce Suzanne's Law through a very simple procedural mechanism, which would go a long way to serve justice to the families of those victims. The second point is around the last paragraph on page 5 of the policy memorandum, where it talks about victims and changes to the rights and roles of victims and all of this. Just a couple of points there. The first is that this provision simply allows for victims to observe parole hearings. It's still, again, a missed opportunity here. It still does not give them the opportunity to make meaningful representation during those hearings. And that's an issue that's a long-standing one. This SSI could easily have been altered to allow victims to speak or have a voice during parole hearings. And that's something that I have felt strongly about for some time. Furthermore, it talks about those registered with Part 1 of the VNS who didn't want to be involved in the parole board process. Now, I would question the evidence on that. How many chose not to be involved in that process? How many were just subject to the poor communication that the VNS seems to be in charge of, and that notification of these decisions came so late or out of the blue to the victims and their families that they were unable to participate or unwilling to due to this re-traumatisation element of it. So we know that take-up of VNS is poor, in my view, mm-hmm. due to the opt-in nature of it. I think, again, there was a missed opportunity there to look at perhaps opt-out versions of the scheme or better communication. And we also know that a number of people who actually requested to participate, and when I say participate, I mean observe parole hearings, those applications were rejected. And again, I would have liked to have seen some evidence around that, some numerical evidence. How many people requested to attend the parole hearing and were rejected? Now, I only have anecdotal evidence, but I know it was certainly in the dozens. And I've tried to get some more information on that over the last couple of months, mm-hmm. Especially when those hearings moved online. There were a number of people that were denied access to that. Should the parole board rules not be explicit in making it clear to victims way in advance and up front that they have the absolute right to observe hearings unless there is good reason for them not to, or a reasonable objection is made. And it shouldn't be a matter of discretion for the person in charge of that parole board hearing. I do have questions about that as well. So again, I'm disappointed that we've been asked simply to shoo through a negative procedural SSI on what I think are quite important matters that really could have empowered victims of crime, and it is failing to do so, I'm afraid.
Okay, thank you, Jamie. Anybody else want to come in at all?
Can I ask for clarification in terms of the timeline on this SI and whether there is actually scope to take some of these issues up with the Scottish Government, because it does seem like a missed opportunity not to try to get some of these issues incorporated. I appreciate this is probably the end of a very long process, but it's not a process that we've been engaged with. So I do think it would be appropriate to perhaps enter into correspondence to raise and highlight some of these issues and see if this is an opportunity that, that can be taken.
OK, thanks. I'll bring in Stephen on that.
Not for me to say about correspondence. That's for your decision to do so. But just to point out that the SSI will come into force on 13th of February. So with the recess pending, there probably isn't scope for this to come back to the committee. The SSI will come into force on the 13th of February, unless any committee member or other member lodges a motion to annul. But of course, there's nothing to stop the committee seeking further information or making the points that you have made in various letters, if that's something you choose to do so.
Can I clarify something? Convener? Thank you. With permission. Again, it's not the first time we've been put in this position where days before something comes into legislation, we've been asked to review it, especially ahead of a recess where there's no opportunity to discuss the matter till after it's come into force. It would be a different matter, for example, if there were things in here that one would oppose. So if there were clear policy differences or matters of opinion that where it was suitable to oppose it, there's little to oppose in the sense that there's nothing I disagree with. But some of the sensible changes that it does seem to be making, but there certainly are things that it could have done differently or better or should have been added to it. And that's where it's unclear. If your only option is simply just to lodge a motion to annul, then you're losing 70% of the good bits. Even if you have a problem with the other 30%, and that's the unfortunate position we're in. So, in this scenario, I think there's no point in stopping it going ahead. But I do wonder how we can raise these issues, because they could perhaps be dealt with in a further SSI, which I'm sure the government could find an appropriate way to come to. With good time, and we should stress this to the Cabinet Secretary, we should have had paper on this weeks ago.
Thank you, Jamie. I think that kind of covers off what I was going to suggest. I think the points that members have made are really valid ones, and it's not just one or two. We've largely picked up issues across quite a number of these specific areas where around which the SSI is relevant. So I'm grateful to members for highlighting their concerns and thoughts around that, and obviously we now have them on the record as well. So I think just to sort of sum up, if anyone, unless anyone's planning a motion to annul, which we've spoken about, and we have no sort of further recommendations to make, then we'll proceed as planned. But I think it is important that we do use the opportunity to draw attention to the matters that have been raised with the Parole Board and the Cabinet Secretary, and perhaps we can incorporate some further work on that at a future point. I'm grateful to members for raising these, but as it stands at the moment, are members content not to make any recommendations to the Parliament on the instrument, with the caveat that we perhaps do some further work on the points raised? Members happy with that? Fulton, can you just confirm that you're happy with that?
Yep.
Okay. What's your answer? Short and sweet. Okay.
What options are available to us? Can we lodge some kind of motion?
So,
I can speak to Russell separately.
Okay. Do you want to speak to Stephen separately on that? You want to do that just now, or are you wanting Clarity around?
If it needs to be acted upon now, because if we don't do it now, is that...
I'll take it.
Yeah. So essentially, it's a process of any member speaking to the Chamber office and lodging a motion to annul, and I can speak to yourself, Mr. Finlay, after the meeting about the details of doing that, but that would probably have to be done fairly swiftly, and then arrangements are made for that motion to be considered and debated, and I can go through the process with you. But it would be fairly imminent. You would need to do that in the next day or two. Yeah. But I'll catch you at the end of the meeting if that helps, Mr. Finlay. We can go through the process.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you very much indeed. So that concludes our public session for today's meeting, and we'll now move into private and just take a short comfort break. Thank you very much.